When I first started teaching at the ELI, it was pretty much, here are courses, show up on these days at these times, enjoy teaching, and that was it. But over the years, and especially with Meg coming into the directorship of ELI, she did, I think, a fantastic job of giving the faculty a lot of opportunities for input, not just in terms of asking what kind of curriculum we wanted, but letting us experiment with different ways of operationalizing our ideas. It didn't happen overnight, but we were organized faculty committees, and we tossed around ideas. We decided on a course of action, and then we did it. So we were all very happy in terms of the degree of academic freedom. Thinking back on when we first learned about the possibility of an education syndicates partnership, oh my goodness, there was a lot of uncertainty for quite a long time. Meg did the best she could about keeping us informed of what might happen. And the truth is, she was also kept in the dark for a lot of the important decision, which is really unconscionable, in my opinion. But that's just what happened. I can't remember the first day I heard, but certainly after it all started, we all got bits of pieces of information, and we were all trying to put it together and operating on a little bit of fact and a little bit of rumor. You'd hear one thing from one source, but then a week later, we'd get another piece of information. And as teacher, we're all trying to analyze, how does this go together? And you know, Meg was doing the best she could under the very difficult circumstances of letting us know what was going on and when. Probably the most important meeting of all was the faculty meeting when we had it with Clark, and he came and introduced himself, told us what was happening. It did not go well. All the faculty were crammed into this little corner classroom in Thompson Hall near the bathrooms. So we've got like 40 faculty jammed in there with a couple of folks from the administrative clerical side. Clark came in and he basically introduced himself and tried to let us know that there are no worries. He gave us the history, his history, of how he came to be the new director. At the time, I believe Clark was the coordinator for the university experience for freshmen, and he's also a tenured faculty in the College of Engineering. You're probably familiar with the typical first semester freshman course. So essentially, Clark said that he was at a meeting with some top-level administrators with HVU folks, and there was this proposal on the table to partner with this company called Education Syndicates Partnerships, which would have them come in and run the English language program on behalf of HVU. That may not be the exact quote, but that was certainly the meaning that he gave us. Education Syndicates would run the ESL program. It did not go over very well, obviously. So when he said the reason he was a director, it was because the provost asked him at a meeting, is there anyone here who would like to take the lead on this and be the director of the new initiative, this new partnership? Clark said the room was absolutely silent, and he looked around to see, and he said to himself, this would be a great opportunity. So he would step up and take the reins on this. Oh, so nice of him to do that, to save the day and impress the provost at the same time. So the provost said, thank you so much, Clark. Now you're the head of this partnership. More like a coronation. I'm not sure what his official title was at the time of our faculty meeting, but it was essentially clear that he was now the director of the English Language Institute at HVU. I honestly don't know if there was ever any serious consideration made whether or not to keep Meg as the director. Clearly, she wasn't invited to that early meeting with the provost and the high-level administrators. I know that this was the result that she was no longer officially the director of the English Language Institute, and from that moment forward, there was a tremendous amount of hostility towards Clark. Yeah, a great deal of hostility toward Clark for a lot of different reasons. First of all, here he was, a no longer teaching professor of engineering, now in charge of a freshman orientation course. What did he know about our profession? He never even stepped foot in an IEP. I think most of us were thinking that we could not imagine the provost selecting one of us to come in and run the program or a department for the College of Engineering. We just thought, what background does he have? It doesn't make any sense. So Clark told us what a wonderful company Education Syndicate was. You know, he gave us all sorts of descriptions of some of the benefits to the students and to the faculty. He started describing the Pathways program, and I told him that my first teaching position here at HVU a good number of years ago was teaching a grammar and compensation course for non-native speakers. And those courses had been cut by the university because when HBU had its Northwestern Commission of Colleges and Universities accreditation, that they would no longer permit those courses to be taught as credit courses and were deemed as remedial due to the student population. So here Clark was coming in, giving us this description of exactly the courses I taught. And I asked whether the NWCCU had changed their opinion about these remedial type courses. Can we teach this again? And obviously he had no clue of the history of what was being done or what had been done in the past. It was obvious from the expression on his face that it was the first time he'd ever heard of all of this. And obviously that issue must have been resolved since we do now have pathways courses that are essentially very similar to the courses that we had before. And how the NWCCU works, I don't know. So during the Dog and Pony Show, that was the faculty meeting, Clark went on about all the money that was going to come in into the university and the fantastic building that was going to be built, you know, because of all this projected revenue. When our faculty members asked a very obvious question, since we're going to have all this extra money, will we be getting raises? And Clark's response was rather hostile. Too soon. It's too soon to ask that kind of question. Maybe in 5 years or so, if the partnership becomes profitable. And then bang, closed that down. Next question. I don't think there actually was a question for a while. As faculty, we were essentially told at this meeting that the deal was done, and so we just had to live with it. And even then, we really didn't know what was going to happen. Just that the partnership was being formed and that we would have more students coming into HBU. Clark also tried to sell it as, Clark also tried to sell it as, and for those of you who are working part-time, you'll now have the opportunity to work full-time, which again, Sabine raises her hand and says, for those of us working part-time, we chose to work part-time. And for those of us working full-time, we're basically up to our eyeballs in so much work, we can't take on any more work. And again, this is all new to Clark. He had no idea of the faculty, he didn't know us, he didn't know our needs, he didn't know how many classes we were teaching as full-time. He thought, well, since in engineering, his full-time load was one or two classes each term, he thought our full-time load was one or two classes, not realizing that we were teaching four and sometimes five classes. Weeks, maybe it was months later, there was this huge to-do with the Education Syndicates Agency, who were all coming down from all over the world to see the latest U.S. acquisition of education syndicates. Meg asked the entire faculty if we wouldn't mind putting on the dreaded education syndicates t-shirts. We resisted and put them on anyway. Many of us tried to cover up the education syndicates logo. Ugh, I'm sure I'm not the first person you've interviewed to mention this shirt. So anyway, there was this big reception for those visiting agents and education syndicates corporate guys. And Meg, to her credit again, kept optimistic, saying, look, this is coming, we can't do anything about it, let's just try to make the best we can of it. So we were all mingling among the education syndicates visiting agents. Be friendly to the agents. If they ask questions, answer their questions. Well, let's just get this over with. So at one point I found myself in the vicinity of Mr. Education Syndicates himself, the corporate president of Education Syndicates, and I had to say I found him rather boorish. We were in the very corner of the table in the back, and he was there making side comments about everyone and everything that was going on, in full earshot of me and the other two faculty who were sitting there with him. I couldn't believe it. Even with me, we were all introducing ourselves, you know, hi, my name is Sabine Reinch. I've taught here for X amount of years, or whatever I said. And because he doesn't, I don't know what to say. Maybe he was in his 60s or 70s. He kind of had that generation of the Brits whose parents experienced World War II. And it was a big influence. So anyway, he got this peculiar look on his face and said to me, Sabine Reich, oh, are you German? And you could kind of see those gears turning in his brain. And you could see that he was thinking, oh, you Nazi motherfucker, in his face. Well, actually, I said, my father was Swiss. My mother, she's American. No response. Again, he was sort of making a crazy comment about different people around us. Very unprofessional. And again, in full earshot, asked to give, or in full earshot, as if to suggest that we little people didn't really matter in the big picture, or his picture. During some of this turmoil, before the dust of the overtake finally settled, several of us got together with this idea of forming our own school. And, you know, I suppose that the idea is kind of still floating out there, but it's not as quite as urgent as it seemed to be when we were really in flux and didn't know what was going to happen to any of us. Ultimately, people moved into their own domains of teaching, and those of us who wanted to distance ourselves from education syndicates found our way into academic or general English programs rather than pathways. There was an opportunity for me and for others to apply for full-time instructor lines, just as Clark had alluded to during the first meeting. But, you know, there are a lot of teachers who need benefits, and I have benefits through my husband, so I really didn't need these benefits. I was just left happy to let someone else apply and get those things. And just because I'm considered adjunct, I still participate actively in the development of curriculum. We've still got some work to do sharpening the general English curriculum, and I'm happy to do that. The bottom line is, when education syndicates first came in with so many changes, there was so much uncertainty, you know. We really had to wonder how much heart we had to put into something that might not be going anywhere. And so I knew if I just stuck with teaching, and I could do much better as a teacher. I would hope that the students would be getting something out of it, obviously. And I'm relatively happy with how things have turned out for me in this picture.